Here we're going to talk about what are called complex numbers, and I thought we'd start off considering the following equation. Let's say that somebody asked you to solve x squared plus 4 is equal to 0. Now think about what you're being asked here. You're asked to find a number such that when you square it, you get negative 4. Now the problem is that all the numbers we've met so far, that is, they're real numbers. Right? Every time you take a real number and you square it, you always get a positive. You're never going to get a negative. So the real numbers, there'd be no solution. So we haven't met a number with this property. Now, before we begin talking further about numbers, I would just like you to consider what a number is. So I would like you, wherever you are right now, to whatever room or wherever whatever environment you're in right now, point to the number 3, okay? So where is the number 3? Now you may look around and say, oh, I see 1, 2, 3 birds or 1, 2, 3 clouds, but the number 3 does not exist in nature, right? We use it to describe things in nature, but the number 3 is a human invention. Same with like the number -4, right? Now -4 is even more complicated, right? Point to -4. Well, clearly that's used for things like, you know, temperature 4 degrees below zero, or like in finance, you know, $4 less than zero. But you're certainly not going to be able to look in nature and point to the number -4. It's a human construct. Now, the number 3, the counting numbers were used, you know, starting like 40,000 years ago. So people were notching like bone or whatever it was, counting, right? I see 3 gazelle or, you know, 7 tigers or whatever it was, right? The number -4, that's much more complicated, right? It's much more abstract. Now that would appear in the history 2,000 years ago. So 2,000 years ago, people first began discussing negative numbers. Now the point of these is that these are human inventions. They're human creations, human inventions. Now all numbers are human inventions, okay? So these are clearly useful, right? 3 is clearly useful, -4 is clearly useful. Now it turns out about 500 years ago, people discovered another type of number that's useful as well, or they rather created another type of number that's useful. And that number is as follows. It is the number that you square to get -1. Now, we haven't seen a number like that yet, right? It's not a real number. It's a new type of number. It's another human invention. We've invented numbers at different stages throughout history. 500 years ago, somebody invented the following number, that when you take it and square it, you get -1. Okay? That special number is denoted with an I. So what is I? I is the square root of -1. Now, we don't have a number. We didn't have a number like that, right? We didn't have a number that you squared to get a negative. It's an invention, okay? And this is our definition of what we're going to be using in this section. So I is the number that you square to get -1, and it by definition is the square root of -1. Now, we're going to work with I like we work with the variable x. So let me go ahead and just fill in this little table. 500 years ago, somebody created the number I, okay? And I is not a real number. It's a new type of number. So let's go and see how to work with it algebraically. Okay, so we're gonna multiply 3i by 5i. Now remember what I said, we're gonna treat the I like an X. So in that case, well, if I was, you know, if it was like an X, 3 times 5 is 15, and then I times I is I squared. Now remember what we said. I is the number that you square to get -1, right? Let's write that back down here. I squared is equal to -1. So everywhere you see an I squared, you can replace it with -1. So this is 15 times -1, which is -15. That would be our answer. Now it's important that you realize that I is not -1. -1 is -1. I squared is -1, and that's because I It's not negative 1, it's the square root of negative 1. Okay, there's a big difference between those two. Okay, let's multiply 2i by 2i. Well, likewise, that's going to be 4i squared. And of course, I squared, we said a moment ago, is negative 1. So it's 4 times negative 1, which is negative 4. Now think about that for a second. That's saying that if you take 2i and you multiply it by itself, you get negative 4. In other words, 2i squared is negative 4, right? Because you're multiplying a number by itself. Now earlier on the previous page, we had the equation x squared was equal to negative 4. And what that meant was we were looking for a number such that when you square it, you get negative 4. We found one, right? Look, 2i, we squared it and we got negative 4. That means this equation now has a solution. The solution, or one solution I should say, is 2i. Okay, why? Because plug it in. You square it, you get negative 4. And that's one of the most useful properties of a number involving I, which we're going to see later on. We're going to call these complex numbers. A complex number allows you to have solutions to polynomial equations that you weren't able to solve solely using the real numbers. Okay, now it turns out this equation has another solution, and it's negative 2i. So this equation actually has two solutions, 2i and negative 2i. And you can check that negative 2i works as well. Take negative 2i and square it. And that gives you positive 4i squared, but I squared is negative 1. So it's 4 times negative 1, which is negative 4, okay, which is what we wanted. So notice that this polynomial equation has two complex solutions. And that turns out to always be the case. If a polynomial equation has one solution involving I, it has a second solution involving I, just where the sign has been changed. Okay, and we'll talk more about that in a second. Okay, let's try some more kind of like this. Okay, let's multiply I root 7 times I root 7. Well, notice why I put the I before, I put the I before the radical so that you wouldn't accidentally think the I is under the radical. So this is going to be I squared, right? I times I is I squared. Now what is the square root of 7 times the square root of 7? That's just equal to plain old 7. Now I squared is negative 1, so it's negative 1 times 7, and that's just equal to negative 7. Okay, let's try one like that in a more general setting. I root b times I root b, where b is any positive real number. So here we get I squared. Okay, now root b times root b, just like the square root of 7 times the square root of 7 was 7, right? The square root of b times the square root of b is just b. And I squared is negative 1, so it's negative 1 times b, which is just negative b. Okay, now, what that's telling you, this is your answer, right? But it's telling you that if you take I root b and you square it, let's write this down, I root b and you square it, you get negative b, right? Now what that means is that the square root of negative b must be I root b, because by definition the square root of something is what you square to get whatever number you're interested in, right? So let me write this down, that the square root of negative b, right, what that denotes is what you square to get negative b. Well, I square I root b to get negative b. So the square root of negative b is I root b, okay? This is the most important property for us in this section. And what it says is this, if you have a negative under the square root, the way you can deal with that is by putting an I on the outside and the negative is no longer under the square root. Okay? Now, when we work with this algebraically, we're always going to do this first. Okay? This is a priority for us. This is really important. Okay, let's go ahead and see how we're going to make use of that now. Let's simplify the square root of negative 18. Remember what we said. Whenever you have the square root of a negative, you can get rid of the negative as long as you put an I on the outside. So this becomes I times the square root of positive 18. That's always your first step. Okay, and then now we can simplify the square root of 18, And that's I times the square root of 9 times 2. And then, of course, this is, well, the square root of 9 is 3. And so we'll have 3i times the square root of 2. And that would be our answer. Now, I'd just like you to stop and think for a moment about what you're looking at here. This is 3. Well, you know the number 3, the number 3 you know and love. I, which is our new number, right, times the square root of 2. Now, all three of these numbers, 3, I, and the square root of 2, they were all discovered at different stages in the history of humankind. And math is very cross-cultural. So lots of different cultures contributed to the development of these numbers. And they occurred throughout, you know, different stages of history. So when you see something like 3 multiplied by I times the square root of 2, this is like a cultural tradition passed down to you from our ancestors, right? Because it's like looking at history. Whoa, look at all these fascinating numbers, and we're using them all due to the age we live in now. So this is sort of like a message to us from our ancestors gone by, saying, hey, you know, look at all these inventions we created for you to make use of in your life now. Now, we've seen numbers just involving I at this stage, right? But it turns out there's a more general type of number, and that would be something like this. 4 plus 5 times I, okay? Now, this involves a real number that you've seen before and also this new type of number. So the 4 right there, that's called the real part of this number. So the real part is the 4. And the 5, just that 5, that's called the imaginary part. So this is the 5 is the imaginary part. And the imaginary part is whatever's multiplied by the I. The whole number, the whole thing, right? When a number has a real part and an imaginary part, the whole thing is called a complex number. Okay, that's what we mean in math when we talk about a complex number. It doesn't have to just be plain old, you know, something I. It can have a real part as well. So generally, a complex number is A plus B times I. I was the new concept we had to introduce, but a complex number has a sort of greater form here. Okay, let's see how to work with complex numbers now. Let's simplify this. Now, this is an expression we're going to see later on. Do you see the plus or minus right there? All that's doing is it's a way of saving some space. So it's really two numbers in one. Negative 4 plus the square root of negative 20 over 2. And the second number would be negative 4 minus the square root of negative 20 over 2. So the plus or minus is just sort of a space saver for us. Now focus your attention on what we have here, right? It's the square root of a negative, and we know what to do with that. The negative under the radical, the negative under the square root, generates an I, and this becomes positive. So this would be negative 4 plus or minus I square root of 20. That always comes first, over 2. Okay, now the square root of 20, 20 is 4 times 5, so it's negative 4 plus or minus I times the square root of 4 times 5 over 2. And the square root of 4 is 2, so it's going to be negative 4 plus or minus 2i times the square root of 5 over 2. Now at this stage you might say, hey, I'm going to cancel those 2's. But remember, you never cancel when there's addition involved. You always have to make sure you have multiplication before you can cancel. And that's why I'm going to factor a 2 out of the 4 and out of this number as well. So this is going to become 2 times negative 2 plus or minus I square root of 5 all over 2. And I can check that's right. Distribute the 2. 2 times negative 2 is negative 4. And 2 times I root 5 is 2i root 5. And distribution's appropriate because it's plus or minus here. Now that it's multiplication, now we can cancel. So we're left with negative 2 plus or minus I square root of 5. Okay, and this would be our final answer. This has been completely simplified. Okay, let's try one more like that. Let's simplify 2 divided by 4 plus 3i. Now, what we can do is we can multiply by what's called the conjugate of 4 plus 3i. And this is what we mentioned earlier. To find the conjugate, all you do is you change the imaginary part of the number. So it's going to be 4 minus 3i. You change the sign of the imaginary part. So if it was positive, you change it to negative, but you leave the real part alone. So we're going to multiply top and bottom by 4 minus 3i. And in the numerator, we're going to distribute that 2. So 2 times 4 is 8 minus 6i. And in the denominator, well, 4 times 4 is 16, right? But we have negative 12i and then positive 12i, and those cancel. That's the whole point. So the middle terms cancel, and then finally, positive 3i times negative 3i is negative 9i squared. But remember, I squared is negative 1. So it's 8 minus 6i divided by 16 minus 9. Okay, let's replace I squared with negative 1. So it's going to be 8 minus 6i divided by 16 plus 9, which is 8 minus 6i divided by 25. Okay, so that would be considered, that's how we simplify a complex number. Okay, so now that we have complex numbers, now we can solve quadratic equations. We can solve any quadratic equation, and we'll see how to do that next.